And it's a great pleasure to introduce the next speaker, Professor Antonio Politi, a professor of Aberdeen University, a fellow of American Physical Society, and he's known for his classical works in, on heat conduction in low-dimensional systems. Professor Politi, please.
Okay, so first of all, and I would say that this talk today is about stuff that is not yet fully completed, fully understood. Nevertheless, I thought it might be interesting to share with you our understanding of the problem. Is, I mean, generally speaking, is connected to the subject covered in the previous talk by previous speaker, Krivtsov, and the problem is, as the title says, suppression of energy diffusion, and the important difference is that I'm basically going to focus on rotational degrees of freedom. So it's not you should not think in this seminar of mine of particles who move in some direction, but of say molecules which rotate. So rotational degrees of freedom. The reason is that in this context you can concentrate a lot of energy in a single particle, and this particle, because we are talking of rotation, doesn't fly away like when you are dealing with, say, translational degrees of freedom. Okay, the problem will slowly be addressed. As usual, I mean, I'm going first of all to have an introduction, and I'm going to focus, say, 90% of my talk, if not even more, is devoted to the so-called discrete nonlinear Schrödinger equation. Is a model where the problem of this fast rotation is emerging quite spontaneously. But I will also show one slide about classical XY model, because that's another context where problems of the type I'm going to discuss are going to appear. So it's a little bit more general than just the discrete nonlinear Schrödinger equation. The excuse to talk about this lack of diffusion of energy is the emergence in the discrete nonlinear Schrödinger equation of the so-called negative temperatures. Negative in the sense of absolute temperature, not just below freezing temperature. And I mean, say the progress we have made and the results, even though they are still partial results, are basically related to a simple simplified setup, which I'm calling unidirectional coupling, and is essentially very much connected to the concept of adiabatic invariance. Finally, if I have time, probably not, I will show a couple of slides about Lyapunov exponent analysis, but I think the most important part, I hope I'm able to discuss unidirectional coupling and how to extract some useful information. Okay, so let's slowly enter the field. I mean, as I anticipated briefly, I mean, there is this is one setup, and this setup is a little bit similar to those you heard already implicitly in the previous seminar. So you say, still say, important point is one-dimensional system.
Professor,
so that's
Politi,
very much.
Excuse me.
Yes.
I'm very sorry. We do not see that your slides change.
Okay. No, but it's good that you warn me, because that's it's important that the communication is going in the right direction. So I would say this is a very, just one slide for another model where similar phenomena to those I have in mind to discuss can arise. And this is this type of model is, say, closer to those that were implicitly assumed in the previous seminar. So in this case, at the level of the Hamiltonian, you have a kinetic energy component, which is related to the rotation instead of the translation. And then there is a potential energy, which dealing with angles is obviously periodic in the phases. So you can think of something like this, where each arrow represents the degree of freedom of the single particle. They are rotating, and just to make it clear, the problem I want to understand is what happens when one of these objects, one of these rotors, is rotating very, very rapidly. You certainly can anticipate that when the rotation is very fast, the interaction with the surrounding is weaker. So the point is, how much weaker is the interaction, how much slower is the transfer of energy from the background to the particle, and vice versa. Anyway, instead of discussing this example, I'm going to discuss another model. The model is I'm going to give the mathematical definition in a moment. I only flash this slide to remind the physical relevance. It's not in mechanics, I must admit, but nevertheless, this discrete nonlinear Schrödinger equation is a model that is very much used, at least in two contexts, if not even more. But one of them is in optics, where you are dealing with waveguides and propagation along waveguides. So that's another context is at the level of Bose-Einstein condensates, when Bose-Einstein condensate evolving in a periodic potential. So you have two laser beams which define some potential, and then you have the atomic condensate, which can be described in an effective way by the semi-classical approach. And in both contexts, eventually, let's go to the math, the suitable model is represented here by the Hamiltonian of the discrete nonlinear Schrödinger equation. And here there are important differences, which also make the analysis say more difficult than in the previous context, because you do not have here a separation between potential and kinetic energy. What you can say at most is that there is some sort of local interaction, so that's a sort of equivalent of on-site potential. This part here, this Z, by the way, is the variable which is complex here, composed of real and imaginary part. And then there is a quadratic term, which is takes into account the interaction. Altogether, maybe it's more transparent, the evolution from the Hamilton equation, where we see that the first component, which comes from this so-called on-site potential, is nothing but a rotation, is a non-linear rotation, because the frequency is proportional to the square amplitude of the modulus of the variable. And this part is quite clear what it is just a linear interaction with the surroundings. One of the properties of this model, which makes the evolution rather say unusual, is that there are two conservation laws, and both of them play a crucial role, much more important than just conservation of momentum in, chains of oscillator. One is the energy, obviously, this quantity here, and the other quantity is the mass, in terms of analogy with the Schrödinger equation, is the norm. So these two quantities, energy and mass, are both conserved. And as a consequence, when you are dealing with a large system and you are interested, intensive variables, you can introduce the energy density and the mass density. So before really addressing the question, I think it's useful to familiarize with the phase diagram. So this phase diagram of Moussen and collaborators, and it summarizes the states that you can expect. So horizontally, you have the mass density A, and vertically, you have the energy density. And the phase space is essentially split in three parts. The lower part, so this blue region below the blue line, is to generate a state which satisfies the constraint of having a certain norm and a certain energy. So that's unphysical, and Then there is this, say, sort of triangular region, white region, where you have the physically, say, meaningful and standard states, where the energy, sort of the temperature is going from zero along the blue line. These are the grounds. This is the ground state. And then if you move from the blue to this red dashed line, this is the limit case where the temperature is infinite. And then there is this, say, very weird region up above this red dashed line, which is the region of negative temperatures, and there have been a lot of debates on what it means being in this region. Anyhow, I'm going to show you in a moment at least what is possible to expect. Okay, so this is the regime that you expect to see. Now, another slide now about, say, thermodynamic observables and a very, very quick, very quick statements about some basic facts that, and for instance, the temperature. The temperature, as I said, there is no kinetic energy, no potential energy, so you cannot compute the temperature in a simple way, just going to a single particle and determining the kinetic component. So there are quite complicated definitions which stem from the thermodynamic definition of temperature. From thermodynamics, you know that you compute a derivative of the entropy with respect to the energy, and this is the inverse of the temperature. And here, since there are two conservation laws, there is also another thermodynamic observable which is important, is the chemical potential, and the way it is defined is again from the derivative of the entropy with respect to the other conservation law, which is the mass itself. So I want only to say that there are complicated formulas which allow transforming this into meaningful expression that you can put on the computer, but everything is quite, I would say, it's not transparent, let's say. It's not transparent like when you compute the temperature from the kinetic energy. Anyhow, I mean, it's another important point which is useful when dealing with these systems at the level of numerical simulations is very often you want to thermalize your system, you need to put the system in contact with the heat bath. And the heat bath, one of the approaches consists in developing some Langevin type of equation, essentially adding dissipation and fluctuations according to the famous fluctuation-dissipation relationship. In this specific context, again, it's not as easy as in chains of oscillator, but nevertheless it's doable, and here it's definitely more transparent than this, say, quite abstract expression that I was reporting over there. So here, let's look together at this equation. First of all, if for a moment you assume that this gamma is equal to zero, you should recognize here that these are nothing but the Hamilton equation. So that's the Hamiltonian conservative dynamics, so no heat bath whatsoever. So the heat bath is represented by all the terms which are proportional, say, to gamma or proportional to the square root of gamma. And gamma essentially means is gauging the strength of the coupling strength. And these two terms here, which, by the way, are acting on both the P and Q variable, is the dissipation. It's probably the dissipation, while this part over here is the fluctuation. It's possible to show that if you simulate the interaction of the nth particle like this, it is represented here, eventually you reach a thermodynamic equilibrium, and you can safely claim that the system is operating at temperature T and with a chemical potential equal to mu. So that just at least to state that it's possible to run simulations and to be sure that you are representing a decent stationary process. But now, by the way, that's the way this is exactly how the equation looks like. This is the, say, formalism expressed in general terms, but making reference to the variable z that was, sorry, let me go back for a moment. The model is defined in terms of this variable z. If you want, so this variable, this equation here, how does it modify when you want to include the dissipation and the fluctuation? This is the way modifies, so the terms proportion where gamma is present, these are the terms which take into account the interaction with the thermal bath. Okay, so having established this, now let me jump back for a moment to negative temperature, because this provides the justification for going on and discussing what I want to illustrate. This is a space-time representation where, I mean, let me go back a moment to this phase diagram. You see these two green dots. So I'm running simulation in this region and I want to see what is it. So let's, okay, so here we can just focus on one of them. There is not a big difference. So horizontally, there is a space, meaning that I'm labeling all the oscillators with periodic boundary condition from, say, 0 to 4096. And vertically, there is the time, and you can see that since this is expressed in million of time units, it's very compressed time scale. The way this picture is presented is that we fix a threshold in terms of the amplitude of the square amplitude variable, and whenever it's larger than 10, we put a dot. And so this picture, especially the lower one, shows that there are places, oscillators, where the amplitude is large and stays large for a long while. These are nothing but the so-called breeders. So that's exactly places where the energy is very much concentrated. There is a fast rotation, and they seem to exchange very slowly energy with the surroundings. So, so from now on, I'm really going to discuss what happens when you are you consider the following say physical setup. So imagine that you put here a specific site, I call zero amplitude, the square amplitude is very large, say 20 in this case, while the rest of the chain is attached to heat bath. So this is a regime where this is in a stationary state in principle, with the temperature, I mean, just fixing some values equal to 10 and mu, the chemical potential minus 6.4. Basically, in terms of, once again, in terms of this phase diagram, I'm choosing a point which is approximately here, so in the region where the temperature is really positive, so there is no any ambiguity on what is the meaning of temperature and the physical expectation. So in this setup, it should happen that the entire system is clear, and the question is how long does it take, and let's try to understand this process. Okay, so that's, I hope finally I have come, I have arrived at the question. And in this, say, picture, I'm really confirming that it's true that the peak eventually disappears, but you have a first idea of how slow the process is. So this is a logarithmic scale of time. And that's the amplitude. This is the square amplitude. So it's typically, I refer to B as being the mass. So if you start with the value of the mass, which is, say, around 12, 13, it stays more or less constant for a long while, and then more or less suddenly, say more or less because please take care of the fact that this is logarithmic scale, and it jumps down, so this breeder eventually dies, and so the energy and the mass that were concentrated in this site eventually disappears, as it should be, I mean, as it should happen. But as soon as you increase, say, even linear, let's say the amplitude of the mass, the time it takes for the breeder to die increases, and I anticipate it increases exponentially. So, I mean, so just passing from 12 to say 18, you see that the lifetime approximately is increasing from slightly more than 10 to the 4 to almost 10 to the 7. And so that's the point we want to address. Okay, so the first property of this evolution, if you look at this stationary behavior, is okay. I mean, initially the amplitude of the mass of the breeder, I mean, stays more or less constant, as if the process was stationary. And in fact, you can treat this relatively short time evolution as if it was a stationary process. And here there are two ways of looking at these fluctuations of the amplitude. The black curve refers just to the amplitude, I mean, the modulus of Z0, this quantity over here only. And then the red curve, which displays much smaller oscillations, is this quantity over here. I have added this contribution, and this contribution at this level, I anticipate, is the result of something very, I would say, empirical, in the sense that my collaborators looked at the time series, not only of Z0, the position, the amplitude of the breeder, but also that of the neighboring sites. Here the notations are a little bit confusing. This should read Z minus one, and this should be Z1. So this is yes and no. No. I'm confusing. Z minus one is already here, and Z1 is there. Psi is the angle between the variable in the breeder and the variable in the site minus one, while psi one is the angle between the breeder and the positive site. Sorry. So now I want just to say that for the moment you should not give too much weight to the specific structure. It's something that we have discovered by implementing a principal component analysis to show that it looks like behind these fluctuations that there is some hidden conservation law. And in fact, that's really the main point of the entire talk. The fact that for long times, but obviously not for infinite time, the dynamics is such that there is a conservation law, and that's the reason why it stays constant. Okay, so let's. This is additional information over a relatively short time. If I look at the correlation function of the mass, this is again logarithmic scale to show that. There are fluctuations, but this correlation function goes to zero. And that's essentially a consequence of the fact that the background has a chaotic dynamics, and chaotic dynamics is typically, I mean, it means short time correlations. So the correlations irregular, and the correlation are going to decay. Okay, that's another way of showing that the amplitude of this fluctuation here gets smaller and smaller when you when I'm going to increase the mass of the breeder. But I'm returning to this issue in a more, say, clear way in a moment. Now, I want to end this part of the talk just showing what was qualitatively clear from the beginning, meaning that if I run simulations for breeders of increasing mass from 15 here to 20, and just focus only on the red points, you see this is the logarithmic scale that the lifetime of the breeder increases exponentially. So it's really an exponential behavior, and this is, once again, still what I want to better understand. Forget about the diamonds. And now, I mean, I'm starting to discuss a setup which I anticipate is going to display essentially the same behavior, but in a setup where you can also invoke some theorems, and you can draw conclusions essentially in a even though not yet fully rigorous. So this is the setup, and the arrows means essential. Here in red, there is the breeder, and the fact that these arrows only point towards the breeder means that I am assuming that the breeder is forced by the behavior of the background, which operates by itself and doesn't feel the breeder, and the same is true on the left and on the right. So this is unidirectional coupling, and as I said, I mean, in this case, the behavior is more or less the same, and but I mean, at least physically, one can understand a little bit better what is going on, and mathematically, the equations are reported here. So this is the evolution of the breeder, and the important point I want to stress is, forget a moment for a moment this. So that's just nothing but a rotor, a nonlinear rotor, subject to an input which evolves by itself, is a stationary process which evolves according to a given temperature and a given chemical potential. Now, I mean, given this setup, you are perhaps even tempted to consider a yet simpler setup and to ask if this type of phenomena are keep occurring. And the even simpler setup is a sort of, okay, so this is nothing but the same way of rewriting the equation. So that's, I am writing W instead of Z minus 1 plus Z plus 1. So there is no simplification at this stage. The simplification is here. So we know that the mass of the breeder of a short time scale is not changing much. So why not replacing this with a constant, omega zero, so it's a linear equation, and why not assuming that this signal coming from the background is nothing but a stochastic process? After all, it's chaotic, and so why not making an approximation with the stochastic process? Approximation is stochastic process, but nevertheless, a stochastic process characterized by same power spectrum of the signal generated by the background. So in other words, the question we have asked ourselves was, what does it happen if I study a much simplified setup where, I mean, I have a linear rotor forced by some stochastic process? Because a priori, I could not exclude that in this case you already have a very slow diffusion and everything might be traced back to this very, very simple behavior. That, I mean, the answer is no, and I'm going to show. I mean, first of all, I mean, this is a linear equation, you can solve it, and then the consequence, if this is true, is means essentially that the variation of the amplitude on the frequency omega is essentially proportional to the amplitude of the spectrum of the stochastic process. So if you have if the power spectrum of the pseudo-stochastic process decreases exponentially, then it's reasonable to expect an exponential increase of the time needed by the stochastic, the amplitude of the breeder to decrease and to move away. And so this is a picture of the power spectrum of the background. And this is a logarithmic scale. So you see that there is a range of frequencies where the power spectrum goes down very rapidly. And in this regime here, I mean, it's reasonable to expect that if the frequency of the breeder is sitting here, I mean, and upon increasing the frequency of the breeder, you should observe that the amplitude of the background is becoming very, very small, and then this could really well justify the numerical observations. But this type of decrease stops approximately around omega c. Now, omega is related is related to the mass by this formula here. So if the mass is b, the rotation is 2b. So this means that since this number is 30, that above mass equal to 15, the decay is no longer, I mean, quick. Actually, in this log-log scale, you see that the slope is minus 2. So this is, I mean, like a Lorentzian. It's clearly not a Lorentzian process because this is deterministic, but nevertheless, you see that when the frequency is getting larger than 30, which means the mass larger than 15, I mean, in a stochastic process, you should not observe such a slow process. And in fact, let's focus only on the left picture here, where I'm comparing two simulations. The black one is the true forcing unidirectional of the breeder with the background obtained by integrating the discrete nonlinear Schrödinger equation. The red curve instead corresponds to the same process as the background, but now the power spectrum is the same in the two curves, but the red curve has been obtained by randomizing the phase. So that's, if you really have a stochastic process, you see that the energy of the breeder is fluctuating much more. So it's important to take into account the fact that in this setup here, W is not a stochastic process. And by the way, that's very much in line with, say, the theory of adiabatic invariance, because loosely speaking, in this equation that I'm going to further investigate in the rest of my talk, you have Z0, which is rotating, so this is a fast dynamics, and here we have a slow dynamics. Slow but say very smooth, and there are theorems developed for adiabatic invariance which really tell us that when you have this dynamics which is slow compared to the unperturbed dynamics, you can expect that there are some conservation laws, and that's the basics of what is observed and which is blocking in a sense the diffusion of the energy. Now let me keep this, because after all there is no any result. I want to illustrate the perturbative approach that we have developed to verify to what extent it is true that one can expect some adiabatic invariant. The starting point is, say, the zero energy, let's put this way. I mean, so we are studying unidirectional coupling. So from the point of view of the breeder, you can see this unidirectional coupling as problem as described by a time-dependent Hamiltonian, where the Z0 is the variable which describes the breeder, and W here changes over time according to some rules which are external to the model itself. So that's the Hamiltonian. This is the evolution equation, where I insist again saying that W depends on time according to some rules that are given as external to the model. So if this is the dynamics, I mean, it means that the energy of the breeder, that's the energy of the breeder, is evolving according to this equation. You just make use of these formulas. It's nothing more than that. And if it is true that on average for long times the energy only fluctuates, but say there is no any diffusion, I mean, the only possibility is that the right hand side should be expressed as the derivative, as the total time derivative of some suitable function. So what we have tried to do, and I'm sketching the first step in the rest of the slide, is let's try to write this as one term which is really the full derivative of some function plus some corrections, and then focusing on the correction and trying to express the correction as the time derivative of yet another function smaller, and then progressing in this way. Let me try to be more specific. In the first step, now I introduce a function which turns out to be useful. I mean, and this function here, now I compute the derivative. If I compute the derivative, I'm not displaying the terms, but I anticipate the derivative of this function here is essentially equal to the right term here plus some additional terms. So in other words, I can verify that the right hand side can be written as the total derivative of some function plus corrections, and this is what is represented in the last line. So he am basically moving from the right to the left-hand side the total derivative of A1, and now I can represent the very same expression here exactly as the total derivative of a new observable, which is the original one plus correction. Okay, so here there is an error, the dot shouldn't be there because the derivative is already here. And you see that on the right-hand side, there is the sort of residue, and there is an important difference between the right-hand side here and the right-hand side there. You see that the right-hand side is proportional to Z0, so it's relatively large, let's put this way. While here on the right-hand side, the Z0 appears in the denominator, meaning that the fluctuations, the amplitude of this error are much smaller. So that's a much better approximation of this hypothetical invariant. And the next step will consist in approximating this with the full derivative of yet another term plus corrections. And I anticipate that we have repeated the process three times, arriving at H3. And here is the outcome, just to convince you that the process really is working. So these are the fluctuations of the first approximation, H1, this is H2, and this is H3. So they, I mean, are really showing that there exists, it's not a proof clearly, but is a strong numerical evidence that over, say, this relatively long, but not infinitely long time scales, the dynamics is characterized by some invariant, and that's the reason why you have very slow diffusion.
Professor Politico, I mean, more ten more minutes, including the questions.
Okay, thank you. So I'm trying to finish in a couple, say 5 minutes, and then to leave time for the question. So here is a more quantitative way to show the amplitude of this fluctuation, how the way they scale with the B going to infinity. And you see that passing from H1 to H2 and to H3, they get smaller and smaller, and then they decrease faster and faster, meaning once again that the approach is meaningful. Now, I mean, I want to say, come close to the end, also because I have noticed that there is a totally unexpected analogy with one diffusion picture that was shown in the previous talk. So this is my adiabatic invariant. So basically, if you want, is the same as this green curve here, but after adding a little bit of smoothing, okay? So I mean, after adding a little bit of smoothing, you see that that's the behavior of this adiabatic invariant, which then you see that it's not really an adiabatic, it's not fully invariant, and it must be the case because we know that eventually the energy is diffusing away. So, but now the question is, how is the energy diffusing? So we now see for the first time that the energy of the breeder is essentially staying constant for a while, then there is a jump triggered by some fluctuations, anomalous fluctuation in the background, and then it stays constant for another while, then there are jumps, and then again constant, then here you see another small jump. So the message is we are going to have some diffusion on top of this essentially constant evolution with an adiabatic invariant. And I don't comment about this because after all it's not so important. I want only to show, first of all, that if I now look at how the variation of my pseudo-invariant scale with the time tau, so if I wait a time tau, how much is the energy going to change? It grows linearly. So these are perfectly aligned on a straight line. So this is really a diffusion. So the process you see here is a very slow diffusion. This is the picture that probably is going to ring a bell to some of you, because this is the probability of the jumps of this variable, the H3, and not only one, I mean, for one case, I'm reporting for tau equal 1000 up to 20,000, so it's 20 times longer. These distributions are rescaled in such a way that the variance is one in all cases. And so this picture here comes together with the fact that the process is really a diffusion. And once again, as I said in the previous talk, this is peculiar, the fact that this is not a Gaussian. This is far from a Gaussian. And what is my guess, at least in this context, I cannot claim it's true in general, is still, I want to say it's a guess only, because we have to understand, but if going back to this picture here, my suspicion is that the underlying diffusion process is anomalous in the sense that my variable is undergoing jumps of different size, and my guess is that from time to time you have jumps which are distributed with relatively long tails. So occasionally you can have very large jumps with the probabilities that are small but not exceedingly small, and the consequence is exactly this. I mean, I repeat, this is a guess. It should be put on a more quantitative ground, but that's not easy, because in order to verify my guess, you need to extract in some automatic way the amplitude of the jumps and transfer. Let me end here with this picture, where now I'm showing that the diffusion coefficient, which is nothing but the slope over here, the way it depends on the mass of the breeder, this is logarithmic versus linear scale, it goes down exponentially. So it's not an entire explanation of the story, but when you are dealing with very fast rotors, the energy tends to diffuse in a very slow way. This is a consequence of the emergence of adiabatic invariance, and unfortunately, the theory is not able to tell us, to what extent this invariant is really an invariant. So this theory has still to be complemented with additional elements to discuss how the jumps, from the constant value of occurring, and how rare and how large are these jumps. Okay, so that's really a point to stop for me. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Professor Polizzi, for a very interesting lecture. Now, please, the questions. Yes, please, Dr. Kuzkin.
Yes, thank you very much, Professor Polizzi, for a very nice lecture. So my question is regarding your definition of temperature. I think it is from equilibrium statistical mechanics, and you are considering strongly non-equilibrium processes. So this may be a reason for some peculiarities for which you observe, because I know the work by William Hoover, where he compared different definitions of temperature far from equilibrium, and he has shown that they lead to different results. So this may be kind of useful for further understanding of what you are doing.
The concept of temperature is true, is a statistical mechanics concept, to the temperature to a single site. All kind of analysis, numerical analysis we have performed, suggest nevertheless that if I can go back to the setup I'm discussing here, this one, that if I am, say, away from the breeder, already more than three sites, from the fourth site on, I mean, the temperature defined in the way I was proposing or using thermostats to measure, in some sense, the temperature is perfectly okay. So, meaning the following, that in this setup, which is true that it's, say, far from equilibrium, nevertheless, when you are slightly away, only four or five sites away, the system is can be considered as stationary and equilibrium regime. And that's also, if you want, consistent with the fact that, since there is a very, very slow flux of energy, even though this, this breeder here, it's a completely different regime from the background, nevertheless, the rest of the chain is can be considered as being thermostated at the temperature that I am imposing at the boundaries. There is a question, if you want, of the boundary layer, and essentially all the physics, the difficulties are related to understanding the behavior of the boundary layer. I hope that's sufficient clarification.
Yes, thank you very much.
Yes, if you can be very short, Professor Wolfgang Müller.
I try to be short. First of all, thank you for a stimulating lecture. My question is with respect to your slide number 7, where you showed us the classical equilibrium formulas which connect temperature and entropy. When I looked at the title of your presentation, it says energy diffusion and suppression. So I would expect that the entropy of such systems is lower than when the energy diffusion is not suppressed. Is there a way to calculate entropy in the context of your Hamiltonian mechanics?
Listen, I was displaying these expressions because they can be turned into mathematical expressions which can help us determining both the temperature and the chemical potential, simply making use of the fact that we can determine the entropy as the volume of the hypersurface characterized by a given value of H and A, which is very complicated. Unfortunately, I have decided to remove one slide from a previous presentation, but these expressions can be transformed into expression for the temperature, making use of the fact that we know that the entropy, I am assuming in the thermodynamical sense that the entropy is nothing but the log rate of the volume of the hypersurface characterized by a certain value of H and A. Still it's true that these expressions are valid at equilibrium, so to what extent you can make use of them when you are not at equilibrium, that's another story. It's correlated to the previous question, but let's say in all regimes where one is dealing with say stationary states, so let's say in this area here, give us results which are consistent with what one obtains from Langevin equations.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yes. Let us thank the speaker again.